It's 9 o'clock. I'll call the meeting in order. Let's start with the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Hey, any additions to the agenda? Not, can I have a motion for approval?
Mr. Chair, I'll move the agenda as presented.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to approve the agenda. Any discussion? If not, all in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, same sign. Motion carries. Approve the minutes of the January 4th meeting.
I'll make a motion to approve with one correction, Mr. Chair.
Second.
Commissioner Weiss is on the regional library instead of myself.
You want a bet?
No. I can't take it.
I second.
Okay, motion and second. Approve the minutes as corrected. Discussion, all in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion carries. Public comment. Seeing none, we will move on to Karen White.
Morning. Well, you know, when I'm usually here, it's usually good news. At least I hope you see it as good news.
I'm surprised you took the time and came back from where you were.
Well, trust me. There are moments. So, as you know, I run the drug program here in Stevens County. I just wanted to kind of give you a little update. As well as invite you to our next graduation. So we will be celebrating actually a double graduation on Thursday. Dan and Gage will be our 27th and 28th graduate just from the northern assignment area, so the four counties up here. But before I tell you about them a little bit, I just kind of want to give you some updates on the program in general. As you know, in 2017, we received a BJA grant to hire a full-time agent. I'm sure all of you have heard, you know, we're having some employment issues these days. And so we've made some modifications to that position, and we've now hired a surveillance officer or compliance officer who's going to be working 25 hours a week, just going out into the homes and getting to know these people. And then Brandy Warnock, one of the Department of Corrections agents, will be doing the full-time agent work on top of that. So we feel that it's probably going to be a better fit and get us more value for the remaining money out of that fund. So she has started her position on December 15th. She's just about completed all her training now. And then of course, No big surprise, she came down with COVID, so now we're going to have to wait while she's in quarantine for a little while, but we're hoping to get her up and running. I was hoping she could join me today, but obviously that wasn't possible. So she will be beginning her duties, or she began her duties on December 15th. We have enough funds to keep her on until the end of this year, and then we'll have to reevaluate where things go from there.
And who did you hire, Karen?
Oh, I'm sorry, Emily Murphy is her name. She's a Graceville person. So we feel that's always a step in the right direction when we can have somebody that's local. Our last several agent positions were not local people. And so, you know, it's if you come from the metro, this is a big switch for you. So sometimes that's also a struggle for people. Mm-hmm. So Ms. Murphy has been pleasant to work with so far, and I expect her to do a good job. So we'll see how things progress from here on. She will, like I said, start doing her actual home visits and getting into people's homes here now, and soon she's done with quarantine. So, and then the other really good news is that now in December of 21, we were awarded a second BJA grant. This is something I've been wanting for a long time. Personally, as you know, I cover seven counties and three teams, and as the program grew over the last several years, I was stretched very thin, and so I don't believe I could do as good of a job as I would like to in each area. So we received a $500,000 grant from the Bureau of Justice Administration that will do two things. One is it's going to continue our full-time agent in the central assignment area, which is Candy and Meeker. But more relevant to you is it will be hiring a second coordinator, a second me, that's going to be full-time just for these four counties. And I think that that's going to be a tremendous boost to this program. Again, there's a lot of things that have been on my back burner for years that I'd like to do to improve this program, but just due to the geographical area I cover and the fact it was only one of me, and I do have to sleep and try to take vacation once in a while, there's things that can be done. So I'm super excited about that. The federal government is in the process of approving our budget. I don't understand their process sometimes, so why they give us the money and then have to approve our budget, I'm not really sure. So the process itself is taking a longer than I anticipate. I was hoping to have somebody hired here in the next 3 months. They were supposed to issue those awards actually in October. They didn't issue them until December 18th. So everybody's running behind on things. So I'm hopeful by July we'll have somebody up and running, but you know, it's in their hands. So, but I do think that's going to be a really good benefit to the Northern Assignment area. And I will be moving then full-time to the Candy Meeker area. On a personal note, we'll be moving to the Spicer, my husband and I, so a lake place down there. So we'll be moving there, and my husband is retired. So I think in the long run, that'll be good for both sides. But for more of a point today, I want to describe to you our first of two graduates, unemployed, two felonies, two gross misdemeanors, 17 traffic offenses, estranged from his family and friends, unemployed, and facing a long prison sentence. That describes Dan Hodgson. Dan began our program on April 28th of 2020. Fast forward 20 months. Dan is now reunified with his family, and they are expecting their third child. He is working a full-time job that he enjoys, and he has been sober over 550 days. Our second graduate is Gage. Gage has two prior felonies, two misdemeanors, four traffic, and two juvenile offenses. He began our program in October of 2019, and Gage struggled a lot with his addiction in the beginning, to a point where we actually thought we had lost him at one moment on a drug court day. But he managed to come through, and he has turned a corner. He has worked hard to address his issues, and he is also set to graduate this Thursday with over 600 days of sobriety. He is working full-time at a job that he can make into a career, and he recently moved out of his parents' house and established his own residence. Both Gage Odegaard and Dan Hodgson have been a great asset to our program. I think that they are ready to move on to the next phase of their life. So we will be graduating. They will both be graduating on Thursday, January 20th at the normal 3 o'clock drug court time. Unfortunately, I just received word this morning that the Chief Justice has now resumed all remote hearings. And so we will not be having an in-person graduation. I always kind of feel bad about that because I think they've recognized, you know, they need that recognition, and it's part of our program is to recognize the positive things that they've done. However, as you know, we are still not out of the crisis of this pandemic. And so that order came down this morning is that we will have a full in-person or a full virtual graduation. So, and if anybody wishes to join us at graduation, I can send the link.
Do you have anything monitoring after they graduate?
Or, yep. Because
at first this program didn't, right?
Correct.
Okay. Because that's a big, I'll have all this supervision and then nothing.
Yes. So they will remain on supervision for a minimum of 1 year with the Department of Corrections after graduation. And you're correct. In the initial beginning, we did graduate them and discharge them at the same time from probation. And we did find that ineffective. Looking back at our statistics, and I know, you know, they can change over time, but since we modified that program and our first graduate, since that modification, we've had only one major offense. So since 2019, we've not, all of our graduates have maintained, at least to the best of our knowledge, abstinence and crime-free lifestyle.
Good. How many participants do you have now, Karen?
We currently have 15 participants.
Wow.
Yep. So again, the program has grown significantly. Yeah. So we're excited about that. We believe that this new opt-out program, opt-out process that we started, where I monitor all new charges to try to capture everybody, has increased that. And I think it's working effectively. I think it, again, can be improved on, but given the time constraints I'm under right now, I think it's a good improvement.
So So they changed the requirements at all to be able to be allowed into the program over the years or no?
Minimal requirement changes, but not significant. I mean, you still have to have a felony. There's still some basics. You still have to be over 18. You still have, you know, some of those. So MBJ, the federal felony people, the federal people also have some requirements. So even though statistically and scientifically researched people with crimes of violence don't do any better or worse on our program, the federal government says if you're receiving federal funds to run your program, you cannot have anybody with crimes of violence. So obviously that's going to be something we're going to need to really be monitoring closely, especially since this new coordinator's position will be totally federally funded. Mm. Any other questions?
Thanks for your work.
All right. Thanks, guys. Have a great day.
Thank you. Yeah. Take care. Yeah. Okay, Liberty.
Good morning.
Good morning.
You're back for more, huh?
So today's total is rather large. It is $230,173.44. $230,173.44.
Mr. Chair, I move that we pay the amount of $230,173.44.
I'll second.
Second to approve the warrants for human services of $230,173.44. Any discussion? In favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? In sign, motion carries.
There must be some annual payments.
Correct. There is. There's
a bunch of them, yeah.
Yeah, there's the Life Center. Contracts. There's also Caseworks. There's Sourcewell. There's IFS. Yeah. That is the reason behind the significant increase. Second agenda item is approving the above holiday donations that were received.
Mr. Chair.
Second.
Okay, motion and second to approve the holiday donations as listed. Any discussion? All in favor, I'm saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign, motion carries.
The third agenda item is approving the Youth Activity Fund and the Senior and Adults Funds for Emergencies. That's listed as far as the donations.
Move, Mr. Chair.
Second.
Okay, motion second for the donations as listed. Any discussion? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign, motion carries.
Thank you.
New staff.
Yes.
Morning.
Good morning and welcome. Good
morning.
I would like to introduce Regina Lighthall. She started January the 3rd. And she is our new child support officer. Regina will be working in the child support unit where she will report to Mariah Burns. The office responsibilities will include establishing and enforcement of child support orders. Regina has a degree from St. Cloud State University, and she's been previously employed at Central Financial Group as well as the Small Business Administration. Regina is most looking forward to connecting with families with resources best suited for their individual needs. So,
welcome aboard.
Welcome.
The face of the name.
Yes. All right. Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Next up, we have Brian, maintenance. Buy a new truck. Up, Brian.
Good morning. Can you all hear me?
Morning.
Yep. Yep. Yes.
All right. So I'm here to request approval of purchase for a 2023 Mack tandem truck. We were able to acquire, as you can probably see, two different quotes, one from Mack and the other from International. After a long struggle, we were able to get it from International. By the way, we We've been asking for months and trying to get this going sooner than this, but they were unable to get us one. That said, also notice the price of the Mac is higher than the price of the International by a total of $2,601. International was unable to provide a quote for a trade-in on our current truck, which is the trade-in is going to be a 2005 International. And so that is also assuming that they would give us the same, at least dollar figure for the trade-in on the truck. They would not be able to, they being International, would also not be able to provide a truck for us until the middle of 2023, if we ordered it today. And Matt can come with one this fall. So that and several other reasons that I have here are the points that we're making to request a Mac. And if you'd like me to go on, I certainly can.
I have a question on the Mac. Total amount is $127,987, and then there's $25,000 trade in.
That is correct. That is
trading the, that. So does that mean it's $102,000?
That is correct. Yep. And then it, with the additional Towmaster, which is the final sheet I sent anyway here, my back sheet, that cost was $112,499. And that's for equipping the truck with the snow equipment and so on, a standard that they do. The truck, the 127 is for the chassis alone.
So is it 127 or 102? The 25,000.
I'm sorry. After the trade-in, if you look on your first sheet, the dollar figure that I had was $240,486 minus a $25,000 trade-in will be a total cost of $205,486.
Oh, we don't have that.
And you're right, Ron, about the 102 being the portion of the for the truck chassis.
Because our request says $240,486. So you take 25 off of that, correct?
That is correct.
Okay.
Our total cost will be $215,486 for that truck. And that was a budgeted item of $225,000 for the 2022 year.
And Brian, that price is fully equipped, right?
Correct.
$215,000 will equip it ready to go.
$215,000 covers the truck chassis and also the Towmaster expense. Yes, sir.
And we had what budgeted, Brian?
We had $225,000 in the 22 budget.
Okay.
With that, Mr. Chair, I'd move that we accept the bid from Mack for the truck at $215,480.
Mac and toll.
Yeah, and toll package.
Okay, to purchase the Mac.
Yeah.
Okay, is there a second?
A second.
Okay, motion and second.
I got one more question. So none of the equipment that is going in on the trade-in vehicles would transfer to this one?
No, none of the stuff that we typically get new, the plows, the wings, and so on. These pieces of equipment are in service for the one we're trading is 17 years old, maybe even its 18th year of service on plowing and so on. All of the equipment is fairly well used by that time. The pins and so on, that kind of thing. And they do have different hookups in that.
Okay.
Yep.
Hey Brian, just another question too. Is there any discussion about using Minbid instead of a trade-in? I mean, I don't know if you guys have, just the used market's been so strong. I don't know if you guys had checked on there to see what trucks are going for.
You know, to be honest, I would say no, we have not. Okay. We haven't used it in the past and we didn't this time either.
Okay.
Something we can consider, however.
Yeah, just to kind of keep an eye and see what that market's doing.
Right. One of the worst, one of the most difficult things I could see with that is we would end up either hold it, well, we would have to hold it longer because we do need the truck available until the new one comes. So we would have to do it all after the fact, then not have at least a guaranteed price,
right,
you know, to come forward with at this point.
Oh, that's a good point. Thank you.
Yep.
Okay, I have a motion and a second for the purchase of the Mack truck. Any other discussion? Not all in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign, motion carries. Thank you, Brian.
Thank you. Have a good day.
You too.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Hey, Bill Kleindahl, you're up.
Good morning.
Morning.
Morning, Matt. Well, the landfill access agreement for your consideration for approval. The MPCA closed landfill program has hired West Central Environmental Consultants of Morris here to do a groundwater investigation between and upgrade end of the closed landfill and in between the current closed landfill and our demolition debris landfill. And the point of that is to show what sort of impact is actually coming into our demo site from the closed landfill. Because the wells that they have there now apparently show that there is some contamination for boron, manganese, and arsenic coming from the landfill. So we talked about this in our discussions with the MPCA when we were doing the liner thing, as far as in the past, the MPCA has been asking the county to do this investigation, actually to see what's really upgraded, what that contamination level is, if there is any, and then in between. Well, during that process, when we talked about putting that liner on to get to phase four, PCA had agreed to work to have the MPCA closed landfill program do this investigation. And that way we'll see, you know, how much they are contributing to the impact of the three wells that we have at the demo site. So Matt is here from WCEC. I provided the access agreement for your consideration. Matt also provided an aerial photo showing the proposed boring locations and possibly where the wells would be located. And then also their work plan that they provided to the MPCA as far as the type of work that they plan to do out there. So I guess Matt's here. If you have any questions or if you want further,
So Matt, what's the timeline on this?
We want to get this done. We'd like to start doing the drilling in February.
Oh.
Yeah, why not? It's the middle of this snowstorm.
And you can drill through the frost and so okay.
No, the sooner we'd like to get it all done before the fiscal year end, which is the end of June.
Okay.
So we want to get right out there and do the soil blends and the lab for lab results, and then we decide where we want to put the entering wells.
And I'm pleased with this action because I think we need to know once and for all where some of this contamination is coming from, and it's all paid for by that.
And where we're doing the borings, it's not just where we're built. We're expanding all the way around.
Okay,
great. Down gradient and beyond.
It's information we've needed for a long time, I think.
So this will get to my question, Bill, about what's naturally occurring and what's from the landfill.
Well, yeah, you know, especially the upgrade after site gradient, you know, that nothing's flowing through it now. Yeah. If it's there, it's there. And maybe it's, you know, it's impacting as well as whatever's in there as far as waste product, too.
Matt, how long will that monitoring go on?
Oh, it'll go on for a long period of time. Yeah. I mean, you know, typically we go every 3 to 6 months, and each one of those is just one data point. So you got to get it takes time to get a lot of data points to determine what's happening.
So there's going to be 20 wells then total from what we have. Well, so it says we have 10 existing.
Oh, with the ones that are existing,
the ones that are there already.
Yeah.
Probably, I guess, if whatever you
we're putting in out of 10. So five groups of nested wells.
So do we have Riley's
blessing to go on their property and put these wells?
We're working on
it. They have an access agreement.
We have an access agreement to, and with MnDOT, so.
Okay.
Anything going over by my property?
We'll find out.
Water anyway.
Yeah, well, we've, as you see, we've got wells going in that direction. Yeah. So
there's one not very far from me.
Yeah.
In the picture.
I'm glad you're involved. I mean,
yeah,
great.
Yeah.
Good for everybody.
Glad that they went with our company to do. We're one of the contractors for the MPCA. So
okay,
it would make sense to have us
local
right in the backyard. Yeah. So.
It's abreast of how things are going. It'd be great.
Yeah.
So is this required as a condition of our permit?
That was actually just a sort of a negotiation, yeah, handshake type of thing at our when we met with Kirk Kadalka, the assistant director of the MPCA, and his other solid waste staff. Actually, it was Randall Sipple who did a very good job of presenting the reason for the need of this.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And as I said earlier, the MPCA was trying to get the county to pay for this and do it. And so Randall says, well, you know, basically you guys have ownership in this and you've got a program. You should really show us what the impact is coming from the closed landfill.
Exactly how it went.
Pay for it. And you use the results. So, yeah, it wasn't a... Well, let me back up. We don't quite have our permit for phase four yet. We actually did just get a response last week that Lisa, the MPC engineer, has requested some more information. And it's basically for, since Ingebrigtsen's had a fire out there, they've got different containers and the recyclables are in different locations. So they want to see where and what types and how much recyclables, where they're at on site. So other than that, I think after we get that information to them, we should get the permit for phase four. And I don't believe that's going to be a requirement on it because this is an undertaking of the closed landfill program. We'll be able to just do the monitoring as part of their program.
So this isn't like every other government program. After about 2 years, they throw it on our lap and we have to pay for it.
Shouldn't be, because you're paying on your solid waste management tax, you're paying is going to fund this closed landfill.
Yeah, that's where their money comes from, closed landfill money.
And then, Matt, we'll get the reports as well.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah. And then that, the county also sent in an annual report for our demo site, and by sharing that information, our consultants can include that with the report to the people, the hydrologists reviewing it for our permit purposes. So it'll be interesting to see what the impact is coming from the landfill and the cumulative impact
really
is.
Will they continue to pay for the monitoring after fiscal year 22? The closed landfill?
Yes. We're only doing, the state usually uses like MBTL to do the actual sampling, do the first round. We probably won't get the contract to continue. We'll see, but they typically go with
those
other
contractors. And our current demolition permit had required us to do 3 rounds of sampling, spring, summer, and fall. And part of that conversation we had with the Valka and the staff, we were able to get that backed off to once annually and fall. Because their Randall's point to them was it doesn't change that much in a few months.
Yeah.
So
what's there is there.
It's making the county spend more money than they actually need.
Even the people from MPCA were pretty impressed with Randall's presentation that day. He did a great job of presenting our side of it, thing. So
Matt, then you guys are paid straight from the state?
Yeah.
Okay, they need a motion to approve the landfill access agreement.
Mr. Chair, I'll make that motion.
I'll second it.
Okay, motion and second to approve the landfill access agreement. Any other discussion? Not all in favor, signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, same sign. Motion carries.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Phone in, Matt.
You betcha.
Pony Administrator Rebecca.
Oh, long list today. Okay. First thing we've got is the auditor's warrants. Anybody have any questions on any of those today?
What page is on? I see we have a new person doing snow removal.
Yes.
Did we ever, is there a contract?
Yes, we went out and got three quotes.
Yeah, but have we approved the contract?
There's, I don't think we have a contract. I think it's a quote.
Yeah.
Yep.
All right.
I know they've been hauling out as they go too.
Yeah, so we didn't, all the options were an increase, a dramatic increase to what we were paying.
Sure.
And then we got, of course, got all the snow this year on top of it, so.
We have a certificate of insurance.
Yes, we collect that one there. Is there other questions?
No.
All right, if not, is there questions on the commissioner's one?
I had one question. I think it's SWAT.
Yep.
Is in there.
Yep.
It's in the auditors. I can't remember.
The auditors ones.
Okay. I see it's like $1,750. Last time we approved a contract, I thought it was like $1,000.
It is. No, it went to $1,300. And then let me just. I can't. Just double check before I say it. Contracts quick.
Appreciate it.
It increased the last time the. This is the last one we have on file. And they expanded the board, I believe.
So it was revised in 2020.
Yeah.
But it hasn't been approved by us.
It's paid 8/112, page one.
Huh?
Paid 8/112, page one.
Of the auditors?
Yep.
Oh.
I mean, we've talked about this a couple of years ago.
Mm-hmm. Do you want me to?
Well, it seems like that they keep avoiding us.
Yes, they do.
Yeah, that actually isn't approved by the board.
No.
Because they put the 2014 approval on there, and this is.
There's something said 15. Go down.
Yeah, but they.
The last one was you signing it.
Some of these are dated 2020 and some of them are dated 2014, but they can't just.
Raise it on their own. I mean.
No, it's not necessary. The joint powers was modified in 2020. Everybody's got to re-sign it as of 2020.
Yep.
I don't remember an increase from that part of this.
Well, the joint powers was modified in 2020.
This was when I was
brought to us.
This is when I was on maternity leave.
That's convenient.
They don't exist then.
Huh?
8/6/2020 were on maternity leave.
To February 2020, I was.
I thought that said 8/6.
No, it was That's a, I don't know why it says that on there, but this is as dated as of February 20. See right here, updated February 2020. What do you want to do with it?
Let's see here.
It's already been paid if it's in the auditor's warrant.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
We have to let it go, but
I have to do some research why that got filed on there. I mean, they have access to put contracts in there too, to that file. So they could have filed it on there. I can have the sheriff come before the board and get it approved by you or discuss it and explain.
What you think?
Explain then.
Have the sheriff come in and.
Well, yeah, they can't change it without our approval.
Right.
Okay. One second here. I want to just see what the 2012 one says, if you don't mind for a minute. What stand a reason why I didn't know it was allowing? Okay. Just the cost. And this doesn't have the signature pages. My vote is sending the
group. I think there was a number a little further down, 17. There's 770, yeah.
See, and I think we're missing the 2014 agreement because I thought that's when the board was expanded and that went up to 1300, I thought. Let me see if I can locate the 2014, I thought was when we expanded the members. Because this should have, 2012 should have been good through 2017, but it wasn't.
The first one you had up was 2014.
Right, so this is a 2012 one, so we're missing the 2014 agreement in the file.
Oh.
So I have to find that, and that went up slightly, but I don't think it went up to that 1700. And then the last one, it says it's dated February of 20, which is when I was out. So I will have to have him come back February 1st. We'll have to go through the amendments and direct them to reopen it and have all the governmental entities re-sign it as of the last date. Okay.
Thank you for that.
Yep. We'll take care of it. Okay. Other questions on the commissioner's warrants?
Mr. Chair, I move to pay the commissioner warrants.
I'll second.
Okay, motion and second to approve the commissioner warrants as presented. Any discussion? Not all in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign, motion carries. Pitch loans.
Okay, get my sheet here. You went easy on me with the commissioner's warrants. We have to hold them for staff. Okay, pitch loans. We need a loan from County Ditch 18 to County Ditch 25 in the amount of $10,500. I did check with Steph before we had put this in the packet, and she said the bonds are following that. There's enough to cover that. And then in addition, before I take that motion, she just wanted me to mention that the ads for the construction, ads for bids will go the next 3 weeks, closing February 9th at 10 a.m.
For that loan advance, Mr. Chair.
Okay, motion for the loan advance from County Ditch 18 to County Ditch 25, $10,500. Any discussion? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign, motion carries.
Okay, the next one was also another loan advance, and that's from County Ditch 18 to County Ditch 16 in the amount of $8,200.
Mr. Chair, I move on that loan from 18 to 16 for $8,200.
Second.
Okay, motion second for loan, ditch loan advance. Any discussion? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, same sign, motion carries.
Thank you.
County Ditch 3. Needs money too, huh?
Yes, we could have done it all in one too, but.
Oh, that's not right.
Yes. County Ditch 18 to County Ditch 3. Yep.
So moved.
Second. Okay, motion and second to loan advance to County Ditch 3 for $8,000. Any discussion? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign, motion carries. Balances, that's just for information.
Yep.
Any questions? Consent agenda.
So we usually do this at the first board meeting of the year, and it's to purchase things like just for goods and services. So think about it. The issue that we use it the most for is to purchase bulk purchase of gas. We go out and get a bid. It maybe can't wait 2 to 4 weeks for a formal approval. So it's things that are already, it's only things that are already budgeted and approved for those line items. And it's things that we would follow our normal purchasing plan to purchase. So like I said, the biggest thing would be we don't purchase bulk paper enough that it would affect us. It's basically the gasoline purchases. So just need an agenda to purchase what's already budgeted for just goods and services.
Okay, motion and second for a consent agenda. Any other discussion? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign, motion carries.
Okay, thank you.
HR.
A couple of things here. What was the name? Did we schedule? Yeah. Okay, so I just need a request of the board just to temporarily extend the telecommuting policy to the end of February of 2022. Just to get through the rounds of union negotiations here and stuff, if we make that final, or would maybe just do a 6 month extension. So asking for temporary extension of the telecommuting policy from the end of January 2022 to the end of February of 2022. And then the only other thing I had there is we had interviews scheduled for a regular part-time dispatcher on Friday, but it was delayed due to the weather issues on Friday, and they're rescheduled for Friday, 21st. Yes. So I thought I would have a name today, but I don't have one.
Mr. Chair, I move to extend the telecommunicating policy through February 28th of 22.
Okay. Okay, motion second to extend the telecommuting policy through February 2022. Any discussion? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign, motion carries.
Okay. And the next thing I have is that every 4 years prior to the opening of the filing period, the board must by resolution set the minimum wage for all elected officials running for office, for the attorney, for the sheriff, for the recorder, and for the editor treasurer. I put the Minnesota statute numbers there. Historically, I look back and the board has typically just set a minimum floor for all. The board needs to pass that by the end of January 2022. It needs to be filed. You can change the amounts as you want. I just put what we've historically done.
I think they're about right. Sorry.
In the channel, so the, you know, the one challenge is it looks kind of shocking, right? But the flip side of it is, say if you set it at what that elected official is currently earning and then they leave office, you don't have any flexibility to adjust that. So that's why we've historically done that. It's not a target for the rehiring, but I just put what we've historically had in other resolutions. So it's up to the board, but you do need to pass the resolution setting a minimum floor.
A resolution with for the minimum salaries as presented.
Second.
Motion and second to establish a minimum compensation for elected officials.
You need a roll call vote for that?
I don't know. It shows here.
I have a question then. So this is for elected officials. So commissioner supposed to be on here too?
Yep, just the four elect, or the four, I don't want to call them row offices, but just the four.
Department head.
Yep.
Okay, all in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign, motion carries.
Because you guys have to set by resolution your compensation at the end of the previous, yeah. That's why, yeah. It took me a minute. Okay. So the next thing I have is a resolution to transfer funds for approval. When the board authorized additional costs for the sprinkler system, the board of directors of funds spent on from human services based on the audited fund year-end fund balances. When we researched it, it needs more than just a motion. It actually needs a resolution to transfer those funds. So we're asking for the approval of that resolution to transfer funds from Fund 5 to Fund 3 in the amount of $49,110 for purposes of covering additional construction costs associated with construction of a new county highway facility. And we basically went back to what the board had done and with construction of this building when they had transferred, I think, like $1 million or something to cover construction costs. They did it by resolution as well. So we copied that process for our records purposes. So this is just formalizing the motion that had already directed staff to transfer those funds.
Motion to approve. Second.
Okay, motion and a second for the resolution of transfer funds from Fund 5 to Fund 3 for the additional construction costs. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Same sign, motion carries.
Okay, the next thing I have is the pay application number 8 for approval. The project is remaining on track, and I put no major items to note, but that's not 100%. We did have a construction meeting, and there were some issues that developed throughout the week. There's three large concrete related issues with the facility. When they poured the stoop, they poured it to the structural plans submitted by the building contractor, not the architectural and structural plans approved by the architect. So they are working on a resolution. I think there was something sent late Friday for that, because it'll change where those posts are put. And then there's some issues with ADA that it would shorten some walkways and stuff. So that is not an owner, our responsibility. It is 100% between other parties to resolve and come up with a cost neutral solution and or rip it out and report it. Those are the two options. So there's that issue to approve. The second issue is the north apron will be reported at the contractor's expense. So what happened is we added drain tile along that side of the building to, you know, wick the water away. So that was an add by the owner. When they roughed in the drain tile, it came up. And then later on, the downspouts were installed. So the downspouts came here, the drain tile came here, and they just poured that apron instead of relocating that flexible tubing right underneath the downspout. So that's a very easy visual, never should have been poured. The contractor is taking responsibility for that. We do have that in writing as of Thursday. And they'll be reporting that when the weather warms up. They'll have to actually remove it and report it. We did get that issue corrected before they poured the north apron. And so that has been all aligned and we've gotten that figured out. The third issue is a discrepancy with some undersized footings for the overhead crane system. And this is a big one. We don't know where it's going to go yet. They're working on a resolution. The challenge is that we have in-floor heat, and I'm sick about the fact that we're going to have to accept some kind of repair that's splicing into the heating system in a poured floor.
Well, I've been involved with some of that, and it doesn't work very well.
It's a closed loop system on that floor, and I don't know what they're going to propose. I haven't seen anything yet, and it's a big one. This is a complete slab.
So did he not follow the footing size on the plan, or the architect was wrong, or?
So what happened was, and I don't know, what we are waiting for is determination of if shop plans are submitted to the architect and approved. So the overhead crane supplier had a responsibility to submit shop drawings with specified point loads. And so what the architect should have done, the architect and the engineer that were hired, is they should have taken what they had in the plan and what was spec'd and compared them and said, yep, we're approved. Now I've got to issue a modification to the floor plan to increase that footing. So we're waiting to hear if that happened. If shop drawings were submitted and approved and they didn't update the plans, we know, we can kind of follow the trail, sure. The paper trail of that.
Somebody had the responsibility of getting the correct size footing.
Right. So bottom line is we don't have a trail to whose responsibility that issue is yet. We kind of think we know, but we're waiting for the paper trail to be produced. And two, we'll have to be talking about a solution to the issue after the fact. And that's probably the more difficult of the two questions is, this is a brand new building and now you're gonna tell us we have to cut out a part of the floor and splice the heating system. It really isn't acceptable.
Lots of splices in that system too. Lots of pipe. I mean.
Right. So I don't have an update for you on that. I'm just telling you that all three of the issues are not the owner's responsibility. I had a good conversation with Donler about it, and I just very clear that there needs to be some changes. These were three major issues that happened all within 4 weeks, and so we can't have those types of issues continue for the rest of the building.
How big is that slab that they have to? You'll have to tear the slab.
The whole shop floor.
The footings are just, whoa.
I just want you to know that our committee, we've been doing our job. But
that's not your, this is architectural and that crane off plan should have been adopted.
Ron and I didn't like the overhang for the entryway, didn't like their fix for it.
Yeah, this shop floor though is really.
It is big.
I'll show you what you're dealing with here.
If they do have to tear up the shop floor, they're going to have to say, somebody's going to have to be responsible if there's ever a leak.
Oh, absolutely. Well, if they tear up the shop floor, they won't be able to save the in-floor heat, though. Because that's embedded in that concrete. You know, you'll never cut that floor out. They'll have to put the new piping in for the heat.
And I tell you what, there's so much rerod in there.
Yeah. Well, and see, they'll never really cut that out without damaging the heat source.
Here's the.
I was involved with one of the contractor poured too late in the winter and it froze and he had teared out and it all had to go.
Well, yeah, I can bring it up on here.
They tried to splice some of it and it, you can see where it leaked, it bled right up.
Just give me a minute here.
Well, if they have to jackhammer it up, it's going to take them, it's going to set us back.
We'll come in there with bobcats and jackhammers on bobcats. That's how they try that out. So.
But just to get the reroute, I think it would take months.
And we'll come in that does that right out of Elk River. Never buy a used bobcat from them. There's the concrete, there's the heat. And
that's what's in the floor. So you can see the rebar, and then you can see the
heat, the piping.
Okay. Then.
So that, yeah.
I wonder if I can go next here. No. Then this is the crane pads. It's like 1'6" by I don't remember what. And then here's the columns, and that's the base.
Also, the base isn't big enough.
The footing is not big enough in the base.
Wow.
So you just can't cut those footings out?
Well, so So theoretically, like if you didn't have a heating system in there, you could, right? But here's where the pad is.
Yeah.
Is there just one? No, there's three.
Four.
Yeah, there has to be four, I think. There's one back there.
No, there must be more than four. There's probably four on each side.
Yeah, eight.
There's eight.
Two, three, four. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Sorry.
Then they span over there, yeah. Well.
So I'll keep you updated. Either way, that doesn't have to do anything with this pay app. Everything that was submitted in the pay app has been approved to be paid. If you looked at the attachment there that came, again, if you look at this period in place, that's a good column to kind of track. The bulk of it is concrete. The overhead doors went in. Some portion of the pre-engineered building. The materials for the bridge crane came in, $53,000 there. There was some plumbing work. There was HVAC work that continues, electrical continues. That's moving along really good. So that is what's on that pay app for the total to be paid this period is current payment due, $426,047.52.
I'll move that we do the pay application number 8 for approval.
I'll second it.
The motion and second for the pay app of $426,047.52. Any discussion?
I just had a thought on it.
But I was thinking the same thing I was thinking.
There's $116,000 of concrete put in here.
Labor. That's the labor.
I just.
You want materials. Yeah. The materials, well, $54,000.
I wonder if we should delay payment on it until they have a resolution, because otherwise, yes, what do we have for leverage?
I rescind my motion.
I was thinking of that too.
Are you going to hold up the whole pay or just the concrete?
Can I just give me a minute here?
Yeah, and I'll make the motion to pay the difference.
Yeah, but it's not really their fault. We pretty much know that.
Oh, I know. Somebody dropped the ball in between the crane plan and the architect plan.
But isn't that the construction manager's job to make sure those things are in place?
Yeah, part of it is.
Right.
Yeah, you should observe what they're doing. Right. Yeah, you're right.
So
was there any Donler money in this?
Yep. General conditions.
Right. You got to.
I would withhold that.
That's why we pay them.
You got a soup on the job.
Do you want to withhold any of the concrete money?
No. I mean, they did their job. They did it to specs. We've been told that.
Okay. What's the Dunlar portion?
It's line items. It's general conditions. And then it'll also be that CM be at 3%, that 175. So it'd be 13062 and it'd be 18567. So you want to withhold 10, item number 10 and item number 175.
What again, Becky?
It'll be general conditions. So that would be like the job trailer, the superintendent, the garbage, that kind of stuff. And then number 175 is their CM fee.
Well, I think we need to roll it back. No. We'll make them act quicker.
I'd make a motion then to pay app number 8 minus number 10 and 175.
Okay.
Those amounts.
And I'll second that.
for withholding $31,629.78.
I think that's fair.
You're in the math. Are you sure you're good to go with the paying the concrete? No. And I don't disagree with you.
I mean, they did it.
Yeah, the concrete general doing the concrete work was told this is the plan.
They were given the size of the footings on the plan, and the plan is wrong.
Yeah, it's not his job to question the architect or the crane operator's footing size.
Okay.
Be nice if you.
So I have payments coming that we
have a more. I need a motion, or did you?
No, I motioned. Yeah,
you said okay to withhold the 31,629.
I didn't have an amount, but I had number 10 and number 175. So yeah.
All right. So motion to withhold. Approve the amount minus the Donlar's fees of 31,629.78.
Perfect.
Any other discussion?
We have 99,700 in current retainage, anyways. 99,000.
Yeah,
we retained 5% of the payments to date, too, until the end. So you have that, too.
Above that, yeah.
Okay.
Okay, any other discussion? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, same side. Motion carries.
Becky, I would just like, before that gets cut and they patch in them lines, I would talk to the people that designed that heating floor system, because that was a closed loop for a reason.
And we don't even have a proposal. I totally agree. And Todd and I had a conversation with them on the days all blend together, either Wednesday or Thursday. And I put it in writing and I said, absolutely nobody touches that slab until the owner approves the repair, the solution. I mean, obviously we'd like the whole thing ripped out and redone. But we're probably not going to get that. And
I guarantee there'll be problems if you don't. I've seen it.
I mean, I was trying to think, like, what else would be palatable? And I'm like,
well, they have a splicing thing.
But they'd have to warranty it for, like,
50 years.
I know.
It's a good system.
I was going to say, long, at least until after I retire.
They've been doing it.
Well, I gotta thank you guys for holding them accountable and for not putting this back on the county. So that's the way it should be done.
They know where we stand.
Yeah, that's the way it should be done.
All right. Move on to two easier items. The EEO report from Merit Systems. So Merit requires that we do an EEO report to them. And so as a part of that, we take we review, you know, this is due once a year in January. We review what we're capable of recruiting for women and other minorities for our job classes. And then we compare it to what we currently have on staff. A limiting factor here is how quickly those positions change over. And then also recruitment methods for folks that are of a minority status. So what we have to do is we have to look at what we have. We have to look at what the statistics for the area are, and then we have to say how we're going to work to correct that if we have the opportunity to hire for those classes. So we're underutilized in one area, and that's the office or clerical. So that's case aides, financial workers, things like that. It does tell us that we should have the ability to hire somebody of a racial or ethnic minority for our area statistically. What we've done in the past is we have tried to send those positions to folks that we know that are connected with the Hispanic community and things like that. That would be our biggest classification to recruit from. We also try to advertise those widely in a variety of sources out of area. We've used ZipRecruiter, things like that. So it doesn't hold us to hiring somebody. We always have the authority to hire the most qualified person. It just is that we're making the effort to try to target those populations. And then we just put an extra one on there. Should we have somebody, a social worker position come open, we will try to make efforts to hire somebody of a racial or ethnic minority in that area. So the other, you know, but the limiting factor is having those positions come open. So that's the big one. So I just need your approval to file this with Department of Human Services for the end of this month for the period ending December 31st, 2021.
So moved.
Second.
Okay, motion and second to approve the 2021 EEO report. Any other discussion? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign, motion carries.
Thank you. The next thing is we last week, Nancy had mentioned that they had a couple of positions for the extension committee that they were looking to replace. So attached is her letter on behalf of the extension committee, proposing to have those two, all three actually the seats, sorry, two member at large open seats and the one youth representative. Vicki Dozdahl, Brian Waking have been nominated to the two members at large, and Cohen Mortensen, I'm nominated to fill the youth representative position.
I'll make that motion, Mr. Chair, second. To accept those nominations.
I'll second.
Okay, motion and second to accept the nominations for the extension committee as presented. Any discussion? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign, motion carries.
All right, thank you. And then the last thing I have would be to go into closed session to discuss a potential purchase of a property for the daycare project.
Motion to go into closed session.
Second. Your motion is second to closed session. Any discussion? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
Motion second to adjourn. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed. Motion carries. Thank you, everybody.